Hello and welcome to episode 3 of the National Secular Society podcast and part 3 in our series of interviews exploring religious freedom. I'm Alastair Lichten, Head of Education at the NSS, and today I spoke with Maryam Namazie. Maryam is the founder of the Council of Ex-Muslims of Britain and of the One Law for All campaign. The National Secular Society named her our 2005 Secularist of the Year for her work in defence of women's rights and the rights to freedom of expression. As you'll hear, despite her activism defending the rights of religious minorities and for freedom of conscience, Maryam is sceptical of the term religious freedom, largely because of how it has been used by the religious right and those cloaking demands for religious privilege. I hope you'll agree that it makes for an interesting interview, and I'll be back at the end with a few comments. Enjoy. Maryam, welcome to the podcast.
Hi, thank you for having me.
You're very welcome. You're involved in such a wide range of activism that I'm not sure how best to introduce you. So perhaps you could start by telling the audience a little bit about yourself and how you became a secularist activist.
Well, I'm originally from Iran. And so, of course, one of the main issues that I've been dealing with is the fact that it's a theocracy there. And so a lot of my activism comes around the issue of theocracy, the role of the religious right, which is a far-right movement, also involved in the state and the laws and educational system. And of course, that's very much closely linked with women's rights, refugee rights. I do think they're all interlinked with each other, as is all human rights issues. And of course, for me, I think secularism is so key in enabling people to have basic rights and dignity. I think it's impossible in a theocratic state or in a situation where religion has access or influence. And so I think that's what led me to becoming more involved with secular issues.
So you say that your background has informed your personal view of religious freedom and your professional view as well.
Yes, definitely. I think, obviously, I would hope that I would have reached this conclusion even if I hadn't lived in a theocracy, because I think, you know, secular societies are the best societies for both believers and non-believers. Of course, I know it's not the end all and be all. Of course, there's a lot of things that people need in the 21st century to live dignified lives. But I do think that a secular framework is a minimum, at the very least, precondition, particularly for human rights, women's rights, the rights of LGBT and sexual religious minorities, and so on and so forth. So I do think, yeah, personally, I've come to realize it having lived in a theocracy. Before that, I guess religion was sort of in the background for me. I was supposedly born a Muslim, because that's the situation for most people. They're born into a family and then they're immediately labeled as that, the religion of their family. And so, you know, it was in the background for me because it wasn't very much part of my life, even when I lived in Iran. But then when an Islamic State did come to power, I did realize very quickly how detrimental it is. I think religious rule is the end of all forms of rights and freedom of expression and democratic politics. And, you know, secularism is therefore, I think, just a common sense response and desire and demand of people, especially those who live in such situations.
So if you can sum up, what does religious freedom mean to you personally?
I mean, I'm not sure I like the term religious freedom, because it gives more due status to religion than it rightfully deserves. I think the issue is freedom of conscience, that we all have the right to any belief, including religious beliefs, but that also includes the right to be free from religion, the right to be atheist, to be critical of religion. And so I think, unfortunately, in this day and age, because of obviously the privilege of religion, the power it has, as well as the fear and intimidation that it can impose on large segments of society that religious freedom seems to be the end all of everything, that, you know, it has to be respected no matter how many rights are violated and no matter what the results are for people. So I think, yes, you know, we need to stress the fact that people have the right to belief, and including religion, even if we don't agree with their beliefs. But I think there's a difference between having the right to believe something versus then having the right to manifest it and allow for religion to have a say in important aspects of people's rights and lives.
I guess a big part of this project is exploring how the term religious freedom is misused. So, for example, to imply that it is a sort of absolute right that overrides all other rights. And also there's, I don't know if you agree, a sense among some people that religious freedom is something for religious people rather than actually being this wider freedom of and from religion, or freedom of conscience, however you might like to change the label, that applies to everyone.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I think it is misused, and I think it is misused deliberately, because we are in a situation now where we've got religious right movements and states in many countries. Of course, the most prominent are the Islamic states, but we also have the rise of the religious right, or the religious fundamentalists, whatever you'd like to call them, in many different capacities, including, for example, the Hindu right, the Jewish right, the Christian right, even the Buddhist right in a place like Sri Lanka and Myanmar. And so I think it's deliberately so that it's considered or portrayed as being absolute, because it does help to keep religion and the religious right, which uses religion for political purposes and for political power, it keeps it safe, in a sense, from the criticism that it rightfully deserves. And that's why I think deliberately there is this effort to make it seem as if it's such an important absolute freedom that it's beyond criticism. And in a sense, I think it's very much when you look at Islamic states where blasphemy or apostasy is the law, you know, that sort of criticism can lead to the death penalty or long-term imprisonment. Whereas in more secular societies, we find this argument being used more and more so in order to impose a sort of secular blasphemy and apostasy laws, you know, with accusations of Islamophobia, for example, but also the fact that it seems, you know, criticism of religion is, and especially criticism of Islam in particular, is a no-go area. And I think, you know, maybe part of it is we shouldn't be using the term religious freedom, because the reality is that freedom of belief is much more expansive and much more wide, much more all-encompassing than religion only. It includes all forms of beliefs, which, as you mentioned, is, you know, atheism as well, being free from religion. And that's so key as well in this whole concept of freedom of conscience. I think one of the things that is very clear, at least for those of us who are involved in secular activities, and also those of us who've lived under theocracies or seen what theocratic rule means for people's lives and the right to believe, we can see very clearly that it affects not just non-believers or atheists like myself or ex-Muslims, but also very much so believers, because not every believer agrees with the religious fundamentalists or wants to live religion in the way that is imposed by those fundamentalists. Because after all, if we agree that it's a private matter, if it's a private belief, then it needs to be adhered to and believed in any way one chooses as a private matter, as an individual matter.
You've often worked with secularists from faith backgrounds, and there is, I think, a perception that freedom from religion or secularism is only for non-religious people. How do you think that can be overcome?
Well, I think, again, that's part of the propaganda of the religious right. Look, when you live in a world in which they have power and influence, and also are very well versed in threatening and in silencing and censoring people, you know, not just individuals, but even states and public policy. They have such a lot of influence and access, even in more secular societies like here in Britain. It's obvious that there'll be this sort of negative propaganda against secularism and against atheism, for example. But I do think that actually people who come from faith backgrounds, who live in so-called minority communities and who've possibly fled from theocratic states and movements, I think actually they know better than anybody else how important secularism is for their lives. And actually that's why a vast majority of people who flee their countries, many of those countries they're fleeing, are countries where religion is in the state or has great amounts of strength, but also they're fleeing towards secular societies. There's a reason for that. People are voting with their very feet. So I do think that there is a level of propaganda that I, unfortunately, some secularists and atheists have bought into as well, you know, always on the defensive. You know, you hear about how atheism is a negative word. Well, it's not a negative word. It's very positive, in my opinion. You know, being able to say you're an atheist, especially in the conditions that we live in today, it's a celebration of free thought, and you know, we shouldn't hide from using it. And secularism, again, of course, secularism is not just for atheists. But again, it's not a dirty word. And I think, you know, we do need to unconditionally and unequivocally, shamelessly, really, defend secularism and not a wishy-washy version of secularism, which is all religions are equal and equally valid. Well, you know, religions are just really bad news for society. And I'm not talking about people's personal beliefs. Of course, they have a right to it. But when you're talking about it in the state or the law or public policy, it's no longer a question of personal belief. It's about power. It's about control. It's about managing and silencing dissent, women, sexual minorities, and so on and so forth. So it's important to have that framework. And it's important for secularists to defend that framework for believers and non-believers.
Religious authoritarianism of various different types often cloak their demands in the language of religious freedom. How can we challenge that without simply just abandoning this label, this term, religious freedom to them?
Well, yes, as you say, you know, religious fundamentalists, theocrats, they are using rights language, and not just with this term religious freedom, but they're also using it, for example, with tools that are really meant to manage and oppress women and those who dissent. For example, the right or choice to veil, or the right and choice to segregation, or Sharia courts. You know, these are tools used to manage and control people, but they do use rights language as a way of justifying it and legitimizing it. And this is nothing new. I mean, we've seen it throughout history where those who are trying to oppress will use language in order to justify what they're trying to do. If you recall, during racial apartheid in South Africa, for example, you know, there was this discussion that separating blacks and whites is not inequality, that people are separate but equal. You know, and we hear these very same arguments when trying to justify sexual segregation, for example, whether it's in universities here in the UK or in other countries. So I think, you know, the fact that they use this language is because they do need to justify what they do. Otherwise, it's so abhorrent. I think if there wasn't this sort of you know, lovely sort of non-threatening language around the issue, it would be too naked for people to be able to tolerate. But on the other hand, I'm not sure I personally like the term religious freedom, because I do think the accent is on religion and freedom, and it should be more. I think as secularists, we should be using the term freedom of conscience more, because that is an all-encompassing term. And also, I think it's important because, you know, we live in a time when there's cultural relativism, and where we find that beliefs are given more importance. Culture, beliefs, religion is given more importance than people and their rights. And so we see when there's discussion of freedom or even of equality, it's usually framed within a sort of religious framework. So, you know, there's equality for faith schools, for example. If there's X number of Church of England schools, then there should be X number of Islamic schools. Or if there's the Beth Dins, then there should be Sharia courts. And what we see is, you know, this concept of equality and rights, which were usually raised vis-a-vis individuals, is very often being raised with regards to religion. And I think that's a huge mistake. It's part of that movement of identity politics and sort of multiculturalism as a public policy that's regressive and that has taken away rights and citizenship from individuals and, you know, given it really to groups and to religions and cultures. And that's why I think maybe freedom of conscience or expression is something that we should be using, human rights language, really, that is all encompassing and doesn't give any sort of privilege or priority to religion.
You have to see that with religious freedom or freedom of belief, that the quote-unquote freedom of a group to impose or to do what they want to do conflicting with the freedom of an individual and that individual's right to be free from the religion or the imposition of it.
Yeah, I mean, the reality is, look, there is no group. And I think that's part of the problem. We've moved away from the concept of individual rights and citizenship, universal rights, and moved into something where, you know, it's multi-faithism, multiculturalism as a public policy, and sort of groups and communities that have rights without any regard of what happens to the individual. The idea of group rights gives the impression that there's homogeneity, that there is agreement within the so-called group or community about issues. And of course, that's not the case. Every group, no matter how homogenous it is portrayed, there is huge amounts of dissent and disagreement, political movements, social movements within that really is erased and ignored and disregarded when we look at communities as groups and give rights to the group. And basically, when we do that, we are really giving rights to those in power to decide what is appropriate and not appropriate for the group in question. And so in a context where the religious right has power and influence, what we see is the so-called Muslim community is then you know, equated with the most regressive amongst them. It's usually those in power, those who have you know, some sort of links with the Islamist movement. We see that very clearly now in the Islamic societies, in the Sharia courts, in the Islamic organizations. There are many, many links with Islamic states and movements, and yet they are often portrayed as representatives of the Muslim community, whereas, of course, the so-called Muslim community has as many socialists and feminists and secularists and free thinkers as any other group of people. And by, you know, looking at the so-called freedom of a group, we're really denying individual rights, we're censoring and suppressing dissent, and not allowing for real solidarity to take place. Because if you only see a homogenous community and you don't see the dissent, then, you know, you have so-called progressives showing their solidarity with the so-called Muslim community by siding with the Islamists, because that's what happens when you see only a homogenous group and not the protests and dissents taking place within.
Religious authoritarianism and this effort to redefine religious freedom is a very international movement. I mean, if the the Hindu Vita, Christian right, Islamist right in this country, very international links. Do you think that the people who are defending what we might see as genuine religious freedom or freedom of conscience, do they need more of an international focus as well? Or are the issues that we're dealing with country specific?
I think that, of course, it's, you know, an international movement. I think in the same way that the religious right, the fundamentalists, they see their links with each other. They know that if one is strengthened, it strengthens the other because they belong to the same movement. And likewise, any gain made for secularists in any country is a gain for all of us. And I think there is a lot of work being done internationally. There's a lot of linkages. I mean, if you talk about any situation here in Britain where you're working and campaigning for secularism, whether it be an end to gender segregation at universities, whether it be an end to Sharia courts or the Bethdin or religious courts, or whether it be, you know, girls at Islamic schools eating after boys or being told to sit on opposite sides of the classroom, being taught that they're less than boys, having to wear the veil, which in my opinion is a form of child abuse. You know, if you look at any of those situations, you will find those same battles taking place in Iran, in Afghanistan, in Iraq, in Pakistan. You know, there are huge links. And of course, similarly in countries where there are Hindutva in India, you know, very similar issues relating women's rights, women's equality, women's subservient status under religious rules with regards to Christian right in Poland, for example. So I think there are huge amounts of links. And the reality is that we secularists are working internationally. Unfortunately, because there's such, you know, such respect for and tolerance for cultural relativism and this idea of identity politics and multiculturalism as a social policy, what we see is that, you know, solidarity is lacking in many segments of society. And that's something that we need to work on a lot more. We need to be very clear that secularism is a universal demand. I think many secularists apologize for secularism. They somehow feel like they need to explain how good it is for everyone else without really having the confidence to defend it in the way that it should be defended, unequivocally, shamelessly. And, you know, we can do that even better if we actually see how much people are risking for secular movements across the world. I mean, you know, if you look at the movements, protest movements in Iran against compulsory veiling, against segregation in sports stadiums, you know, they might not say that they are secular movements, but they are fundamentally secular movements, modern movements, movements that are framed within a universal rights perspective rather than within a Sharia law perspective. And so, you know, the more we see that, the more we recognize that, the more we work with others fighting for secularism, I think the more secularists here will realize how universal secularism is. It really is a human right. It really is a precondition and a prerequisite for basic freedoms and equality in any society.
So then what can ordinary people do to protect genuine freedom of and from religion?
Well, I think, I mean, there's a lot one can do, but I think, you know, if we start with basics, you know, it is this idea of insisting on universal rights and values. You know, people bleed the same way, no matter what their background, and they want to live with rights and freedoms, no matter what the background. And, you know, sort of insisting on this universalism and insisting on people being citizens, irrespective of what so-called community they belong to. And I think if we look at it from that perspective, then we can see why it's important for women, even if they come from Muslim backgrounds, to have access to their full rights and not just be relegated to Sharia courts, for example, you know, and to see it as something that is a duty in any society to give citizens, irrespective of their backgrounds, and any pressures that they might be facing, to have the rights and freedoms that are available to all citizens. You know, and the other aspect, of course, is an insistence on freedom of expression. Freedom of expression is really one of the only tools that ordinary people have in order to oppose those in power who are trying to suppress and to challenge authoritarianism and inequality. And if freedom of expression is constantly limited and restricted with, you know, yes, I believe in freedom of expression, but not if you offend, not if you are, you know, insulting X, Y, and Z, not if you are going too far, not if you are provocative. There's always these ifs and buts. Well, it gives I think it encourages the religious right, which is why they really can do anything they want. They can ban people from trying to speak. They can threaten people for speaking their mind. And what's happened is that those who bully the loudest, those who can frighten the most, they're the ones who are able to have full rights in a way, while the rest of us don't. And I think this insistence on really these sort of universal principles and also an insistence on free expression, as long as there's no incitement to violence, you know, I think it's hugely important if we're going to be able to win this very important battle that faces not just our society, but many societies across the globe.
That brings us on to your speaking on the 14th of February at the Why We Defended Rushdie event at Conway Hall. Do you want to tell us a little bit about that?
The event on Why We Defended Rushdie is to mark the 40th anniversary of the death fatwa against Salman Rushdie. And again, Salman Rushdie wrote a book. You know, there's a lot of evidence that there were Islamists from Britain that actually went and asked Khomeini, Ayatollah Khomeini in Iran, to issue the fatwa. And so, you know, there's, again, when we talk about things having international links, here's one very clear one, where this fatwa then had huge repercussions on the right to criticize and mock religion, and not just in Britain, but of course across the globe. You know, 40 years ago, we were more free to say what we wanted to than we are today. And, you know, you've even got Life of Brian actors, Monty Python, saying that they most probably wouldn't have been able to make a Life of Brian today, given the climate that we're in. And so, you know, it was hugely important and brave for women against, you know, women against fundamentalism, South Hall Black Sisters, women like Pragna Patel and Geeta Sakyal, who went and stood in support of Salman Rushdie and faced, you know, thousands upon thousands of Islamists who were calling for his death. But the world also comprises of people who would like to read Salman Rushdie's book and who would like to write books without fearing for their lives, you know. And I think at the time, and even today, what we see is this constant victim blaming, you know. Oh, Salman Rushdie's costing the state too much money when he was being protected in the early years. Or, you know, Charlie Hebdo, well, if they hadn't done those cartoons, they could be alive today, you know, blaming those who've merely spoken their mind. And, you know, we should really be targeting the religious right. They are destroying rights in, of course, many, many countries across the world. And we have a responsibility to defend those rights, to insist on them, and to defend those who are under attack. And of course, Salman Rushdie is a great case in point. His story really was linked with the rise of the Islamist right in the world, and we see a very different world today for women, for gay people, for free thinkers, across the world. And so standing up for the right to express oneself is really a key fight in the fight for a secular world.
That leads us on quite nicely, because we always like to ask our guests for some recommendations. Are there any books or films you think that do a particularly good job of exploring freedom of conscience that you'd like to share?
Well, I guess I'll give a plug for the Council of Ex-Muslims and a film that was made 2 years ago by Dia Khan. She's a Muslim woman herself, a really wonderful award-winning filmmaker who's done several impressive films. She did one on the Council of Ex-Muslims and Islam's non-believers, and I think it's a hugely important film. Unfortunately, it never got the coverage that her other films got. And of course, it's because, again, this idea of leaving Islam and how dare we do it publicly and vocally. This idea that, how dare we criticize Islam publicly and vocally. That it's impermissible, it's taboo, it's not allowed, can clearly be seen even in the reception of the film. So, for example, The Guardian did a piece on Dia Khan's work. It mentioned that she's done four films. It listed three of her films, and of course, the only one that wasn't listed was the one on Islam's non-believers. So I would really recommend to anyone who's grappling with these issues to watch it if they can. It can be accessed via our website, the Council of Ex-Muslims of Britain website. If you do a search on it, there's a link, and it's also, of course, on YouTube.
Maryam, thanks so much for joining us and for your time. And we'll have the links to the Rushdie event and the film which you mentioned in the show notes.
Oh, that's wonderful. Thank you so much for giving me this chance as well. And good luck with the rest of your podcast.
Thanks again to Maryam for joining us, and thanks for everyone for their feedback on the first two episodes. Those were my interviews with Stephen Evans and Rachel Lasser. You can catch up with all our podcasts at secularism.org.uk/podcasts. This series has been leading up to our major conference in May, Secularism 2019, Reclaiming Religious Freedom. The details are linked in the show notes, and tickets are available for just £50 or just half price for NSS members. The National Secular Society works for the separation of religion and state and equal respect for everyone's human rights, so that no one is either advantaged or disadvantaged on account of their beliefs. If you enjoyed this episode, please consider joining the NSS today. Until next time, I'm Alastair Lichten, thanking you for tuning in. Goodbye.